we look at what's going on in the world today, we see so many different things happening at the same time. And it can be very confusing trying to make sense of the debates around these things. But when you actually look at these things holistically, it starts to make some sense. Unfortunately, what we have at the moment is a lot of people in different fields looking at everything in isolation. So you've got one lot of people looking at climate change, one lot of people looking at energy, a bunch of guys looking at food, some other guys looking at the economy, some other guys looking at terrorism and foreign policy. And what I think is really important to do is to look at these things as part of a global system. And when you do that, you actually come away with a different perspective. My view, having looked at a lot of these trends, is that some of the most worrying predictions are most likely to be true. If you look at these things in their totality, what we're seeing is industrial civilization is unsustainable. And all of these different crises are really just different manifestations of the fact that this civilization in its current form cannot survive the 21st century. My name is Nafees Musaddiq Ahmed. I'm an international security analyst. I run a think tank in London called the Institute for Policy Research and Development. I specialize in the study of mass violence. I've published extensively on terrorism, imperialism, and conflict. And in trying to understand mass violence, I've been looking more deeply at the systemic and structural issues such as climate change, energy depletion, food production, economic crisis, and how these crises interact with one another and how they can also aggravate and radicalize conflicts. I've been trying to understand what is actually going on in each of these crises, trying to get a grip on the debates between experts. So for example, what is climate change and is it real? What is energy depletion? Is it real? How does it work? Well, are these things just something that we're being told? And I've tried to really separate out vested interests from actual data and evidence.
Vision is the most important of the human senses. We learn to see only as we practice using the eyes.
When we're looking at these crises, we're looking at them in isolation. We're unable to see them as parts of a whole. So, to the extent that you have climate scientists looking in a very narrow sense only at our interference with our environment, and looking only, for example, at environmental degradation, they're not able to see the links that that has directly with the structure of our global economy and how that structure in a way compels us to go on this path of infinite growth just to survive, just to stop our businesses from failing. They have to continue growing every year. They have to increase their profits. That's just your baseline for survival. So the doctrine of unlimited growth is a failed doctrine. It cannot work. And it's creating absolute disaster. But most of the experts looking at these things are only looking at it from their own lens. So for them, it's an invisible crisis because they don't really see the bigger picture. Most of the institutions which are working on these things are doing so on the basis of conventional policy-making assumptions. These are now totally outmoded and highly questionable. Two of the most influential thinkers that have been responsible for some of these assumptions are Samuel Huntington and Francis Fukuyama. Samuel Huntington was a Harvard professor. He was a political scientist, and he was also a longtime advisor to the US government. He specifically advised President Lyndon Johnson on the Vietnam War. He became quite well known for writing a book called The Clash of Civilizations in the 1990s. Where he projected that the future of international conflict would be between major civilizational blocks. So the Islamic world, the Western world, he separated these out and said that this is where there will be major conflict in the future.
All I'm saying is that in some non-Western cultures, and Islam and Confucian culture are the usual examples, there's great resistance to accepting Western values of human rights and democracy because these countries come from totally different cultural traditions.
The other guy that's also very interesting is Francis Fukuyama, who used to be head of policy planning at the State Department. He wrote a book called The End of History. And he argued that with the collapse of communism, there is no viable alternative to neoliberal politics or economics. You know, the neoliberal system, where you have liberal democracies, the free market system, these have triumphed. We have no other system which can offer a viable alternative.
Sure, if you want to measure greatness by purely selfish materialism, sure.
All right, then how do you want to measure it?
Well, there are other values, you know.
Now, wait a minute, just a minute. What's wrong with this type of materialism? I mean, it's the difference between life in the jungle and life in civilization.
So the ideas of Huntington and Fukuyama became kind of fused into this overall idea that the current system we have is in fact the most advanced system ever possible for humanity. And the violence that we have in this system are conflicts with lesser civilizations, such as the Muslim world. When you believe these things, when you believe the current system is the best we have, and when you believe that the war on terror is just a war against crazy barbarians that hate us because of our freedom and our way of life, then you're out of touch with reality, and you don't really get the systemic causes of what's going on. So when policymakers see things like climate change, peak oil, the economic crisis, or the fact that we're reaching limits in food production, they try to deal with them in isolation, instead of recognizing that these crises are fundamentals of a failing global system. Because of this ideology, because of these subliminal ideas, we're straitjacketed, and we're unable to respond in the way that we need to. Recognizing that we need not just tinkering, but transformation of the system. But the question is, how do we do that? My view is that we need to go back to each of these crises, understand how they work, and how they're so fundamentally interconnected. Over the next decade, I think we'll see increasing evidence that we have passed the tipping point on climate change. For me, it's very clear, having looked at the scientific data and looked at thousands of different scientific papers, that global warming is real. The mainstream assessment from the majority of scientists that it's largely because of fossil fuel emissions. And I'm convinced that that is accurate. And I've looked in detail at a lot of the skeptic arguments that suggests, for example, that maybe climate change is due to natural variations, such as the sun, or it's due to cyclical variations in the Earth's natural climate cycles. I did this with an open mind, and I came to the conclusion that while these are certainly factors in understanding climate change, they do not explain the current trend of global warming. For me, really, the debate is how fast it's happening. And is it likely to create serious problems for civilization to survive? Most of the policymakers have agreed to this baseline target that we should reduce the amount of fossil fuels in the atmosphere to about 450 parts per million. That will get us to a 2 degrees Celsius rise by mid-century. And if we can stabilize at that level, then we will avoid some of the worst effects. Unfortunately, that's unlikely to be the case. A lot of new scientific data which has come in the last few years, for example, the work of James Hansen, who is the head of the NASA Department on Climate Science. He has argued that actually you're looking at 350 parts per million as the maximum atmospheric concentration of greenhouse gases that is safe, and that actually we need to be below that. And he said once you go past that level, then you will probably go past a 1 degree Celsius rise in global average temperatures. And once you get past 1 degrees, he says, you're looking at major changes in ecosystems that by themselves would lead to positive feedbacks between different ecosystems that could then lead to further changes that are difficult to predict. And once those changes got underway, there is a danger of irreversible changes to our climate that could then lead to a runaway warming process.
You were lucky this time, Kevin.
The problem is, we're really on the edge right now. We've already had a rise in global average temperatures of about 0.7 degrees Celsius. This is considered anomalous, and it's outside the range of up to the last 1,000 years of natural variations in temperatures. In terms of atmospheric concentration of greenhouse gases, we're currently at 445 parts per million, which is well over the 350 limit suggested by Hansen. In terms of where we are with fossil fuel emissions, we already are past the danger point.
Do you know the danger dodger salute, Kevin?
Aware, alert, alive.
That's right. Now let's review what's meant by the danger dodger motto. Being aware means knowing the dangers that surround us. And being alert involves planning ahead to avoid those dangers. Aware, alert, alive.
The official government and international community response to climate change has been inhibited and constrained by the subliminal policy assumptions that we have seen, with these ideas about the neoliberal political economy being the most advanced system possible. When you have that baseline assumption, then something like climate change is not seen as integral to the way our societies are working. It's seen as an aberration. So rather than saying that we need to change the way our societies are working in a progressive way, you're seeing a push for more neoliberal capitalism rather than less.
In the boardrooms of the EU's biggest firms, company directors now discuss greenhouse gas emissions in the same hard-nosed business terms as balance sheets, shareholder dividends, or annual reports. The reason for this change is simple. Thanks to the European Emissions Trading Scheme, which began operating in January 2005, carbon dioxide emissions are now a tradable commodity.
So, for example, with carbon trading, big business is able to invest in some kind of enterprise, say in China, which is probably not very green, and where they're likely to make substantial profits. And by investing in that, they're purchasing a number of carbon credits. The value of those credits is equivalent to a certain amount of emissions. So what they can say is, having purchased that number of credits, that is equivalent to a certain amount of greenhouse gases that we've reduced. So then they can put on their books that they've actually reduced their emissions by a certain amount, because they've spent a certain amount of money on carbon credits. Well, actually, all they've done is invested in an enterprise to make profits and used the image of that investment as a green investment to say that we've reduced our carbon emissions. And in fact, they may well be increasing carbon emissions. So this bonanza of profiteering has been going on for the last few years. This justifies skepticism, and I can understand why people are skeptical of the science, but the science is not the problem here. It's the way in which the political players are exploiting the science in order to legitimize their own vested interests.
Well, it's a tremendous book, and in the Times today, they said that you may be working on being the first carbon billionaire, and in a critical sense, they say that you're advocating something that could make you wealthy.
And we should also be skeptical of the people on the right who are denying climate change while at the same time taking money from the fossil fuel industries, because they are also just acting in their own vested interests.
Hi, I'm Senator Jim Inhofe from Oklahoma and the top watchdog of the Obama administration's global warming agenda. I couldn't be happier, and poor Al Gore couldn't be more upset. Global warming is probably the greatest hoax ever perpetrated on the American people. But let me be clear, despite our successes over the past year, global warming alarmists will continue to push their agenda.
What this means is that we should be skeptical of both sides of the political spectrum, who are quite happy to hijack whatever discourse suits them to suit their interests.
On every billboard, radio and television, on every newspaper and magazine, I want ads in the Boy Scout magazine and every college paper, full page ads in color.
What we really need to look at is the link between climate change, our dependence on fossil fuels, these vested interests who control the fossil fuel industries, and of course the wider neoliberal global political economy, which is designed to meet their interests, and a very consumerist society, which plugs us into that system and keeps it chugging along. All of these things are combined and are working together to push us onto this path of accelerated interference with the natural environment. But if we're going to deal effectively with climate change, then we're going to have to more thoroughly understand our addiction to fossil fuels.
Dad, can I take the car into town now?
Okay, Alan, go ahead, but take it easy.
Well, I'll be real careful. Goodbye.
He'll be all right. Oh. Get the guy going. Hey, maybe we better go along with him, make sure he gets there all right.
Okay, buy me soda.
Okay, fine. Goodbye, everybody.
Bye.
So, there went Alan with his new driver's license and Frank and Betty right behind on as nice a summer day as you could wish for.
Many people are aware of the concept of peak oil and that we are reaching the limits of our dependency on oil and that therefore the age of cheap oil is nearing its end. And what peak oil basically means is you get to this point where it becomes geophysically more difficult for you to actually extract the oil from the ground. And so your oil production begins to decline and it just won't go back up. The question that is on people's minds is when globally are we likely to peak? And what is that going to mean for industrial civilization? Oil production for any oil reserve passes through three main stages. And this was outlined by the famous geophysicist Dr. M. King Hubbert in the 1950s. And he said, you know, first of all, production begins at zero. It will then rise exponentially. It will then hit a midway point where you've depleted half your reserves. And then at that point, roughly, it will begin to decline. And it will decline increasingly and exponentially towards depletion. And that's the Hubbert curve. He predicted the peak of US oil production in the 1970s. And when he predicted that, most of the people in the oil industry at the time said that you're a pessimist, you're a doomsayer, it's not going to happen, we've got abundant oil reserves. And he turned out to be right, his prediction was absolutely accurate. US oil production did peak in the 1970s and subsequently declined. And the US is now a major net importer of oil. It's heavily dependent on foreign oil reserves. So the issue of peaking in oil is a historical reality. It's not a theory as such.
Why don't they look, Ralph? Tell me. Why don't they look?
I've done a quite extensive survey of the academic studies and of oil industry reports around this. And I came to the conclusion that we most likely peaked in world oil production in 2005. And this really is borne out by the oil production data from British Petroleum. And British Petroleum, every year, say that we're going to peak in oil maybe 40 years from now. It's nothing to worry about. But yet their own data released in 2010 confirms oil production was rising, then in 2004 it stopped rising, leveled off in 2005, plateaued until 2008, and then it went down. And that is unprecedented. It's never happened before in the history of world oil production. So it looks like we are there. We've arrived at peak oil. But that doesn't mean that we've completely run out of oil. There's still oil in the ground. It just means that we've reached the end of the age of cheap oil. We're now going to find that oil prices are much more expensive, and that this is going to limit our ability to conduct our societies in the way that we used to.
What's it to you?
At this very moment, you are looking at a film whose acetate base was made with petroleum. You can even hear oil. It's in the plastic in musical instruments. Chances are your day starts with oil. Synthetic glycerin in toothpaste or alcohol in your shaving lotion.
What it comes down to is that the oil industry has to please Mrs. Martin and millions just like her. Already today, she's used some 87 petroleum products, including the plastic bacon wrapper and the wax of the milk carton. She'll top 100 before the day is over.
So are there any alternatives to conventional oil? Well, I think we have a problem with all mineral energy resources. For example, unconventional oil, such as tar sands and oil shale. It's increasingly clear that the energy return on investment, the amount of energy that you get out compared to how much you put back in, is very, very small compared to cheap oil. And it's just not going to be enough to actually meet demand. And of course, the other issue with tar sands is that it's environmentally very, very exhaustive. It relies on billions of cubic feet of natural gas just to produce a couple of barrels of oil. You need to have extensive fresh water, extensive sources of energy. The whole process is very, very intensive and long. So tar sands and oil shale are really not going to help. Natural gas might be able to fill the gap a little bit, but again, it's not going to last beyond a couple of decades. With coal production, again, estimates vary, but increasingly, a number of studies are showing coal production will peak in around 2025, something like that. And that could really only be offset by new discoveries, and I don't think we're going to have many new discoveries of coal.
However, an atomic energy power plant has already proved feasible. The future supplying of electric power to entire cities is far from impossible. While nuclear power in locomotives, submarines, ships, and even very large airplanes may all but revolutionize future transportation on land, sea, and air.
You know, a lot of people say that nuclear energy is the magic bullet that will solve all of our problems. It's fossil fuel free, and it's a powerful source of energy to replace fossil fuels, to fuel industrial levels of growth. The problem is that it's not fossil fuel free. Many studies prove that there are fossil fuels emitted in almost every aspect of the process of exploiting nuclear energy, from going out and mining and extracting the uranium, transporting it, milling it, processing it, and then in the process of waste disposal as well. All of these things require fossil fuel intensive activities. So the question is, what source of energy can we rely on?
Hey, Judy, I'll buy a couple of eggs this morning.
Okay, dear. Oh, but get a move on or you'll be late.
It's a great life, eh, Bob? When you stop to think about it, we take a lot for granted. And why shouldn't we? But you know, somebody has to look after the things we take most for granted. Somebody's got to know, for example, how much electricity we'll need every hour of the 24.
So certainly, Renewable energies are absolutely the way forward.
Solar energy, wind energy, geothermal energy, wave.
For all of these forms of energy, the technical potential is immense.
They could provide collectively and even by themselves several times the amount of need and demand that we actually have existing in the current economy, even if we have levels of growth going very, very high.
But there is a problem.
First of all is that scaling up renewable energy practically, you need to have it positioned in the right way, in the right areas. You then need to have that electricity transported across vast distances. That obviously will require huge inputs of fossil fuel resources to actually scale up that process. I think ultimately, when you look at those practicalities, it's clear that despite the large technical potential, there's no way that renewable energies would be able to scale up in time to meet industrial levels of growth and industrial levels of demand.
Right now, you can ride along with the happy ghost spending, buy it now, young adults of today.
Does that mean that we don't live the high life? In some ways, yes. But does it mean we revert back to this kind of Stone Age existence? No, it doesn't. It's not saying that it's the end of the world, but it's saying that it's the end of a particular form of industrial civilization, which is based around unlimited growth and unconstrained interference with the natural environment. And then that form of civilization has to change, and if it doesn't change, it will not survive. And either it's going to go down with a bang, or it's going to be a mitigated decline, and we could see a much more positive and sustainable change. But either way, whatever way we look at it, whether we're looking at it from the perspective of hope or danger, from the perspective of collapse or renewal,
we are inevitably going to see a civilizational change. But if we want to push this change into a positive direction, then we're going to have to understand these crises not in their isolation, but in their combined impact. And this means looking at how climate change and energy depletion will interact with one another and affect the entirety of our social systems. And one of the areas where we'll see the biggest impact is in food production.
Supermarket, symbol of the highest standard of living in this country today. These products come from farms and ranches despite distance and season. They are the result of a miraculous agriculture. Today, agriculture is going far beyond nature to produce new miracles for an even better, more abundant life. The work of the men behind the scenes is done on the farm, in the laboratory, and in the marketplace. On the farm today, wherever you look, you see the handiwork of scientists. Improved crops, more productive soils, more useful, more efficient machinery.
I'm very concerned that the impacts of climate change and energy depletion are converging.
And it's very clear that we will not be able to sustain global food production levels in the coming years without a drastic change in the way we do things.
On the one hand, you have the impact of global warming. Due to erratic weather, for example, increased droughts and increased floods in different regions, we will see many more crop failures, which will drastically impact on global food production. The other issue, of course, is energy. Industrial agriculture is heavily dependent on oil. We are dependent on oil-based fertilizers and pesticides, and if we reach a point where supplies of hydrocarbon energy are diminishing, we will be unable to sustain industrial agriculture in order to meet world population needs. The problem, of course, is that it's not just about peak oil and climate change, it's also about the nature of the economic system,
which is propelling us to consistently try to get control of more and more resources, to produce more and more, in the interests of a corporate system of agribusiness, which is based not on trying to meet people's needs, but based on trying to meet the profits of a tiny minority of agribusiness corporations, who have no interest in sustaining the environment and no interest in population needs, but their interest is simply to make as much food as you can and sell as much as you can to the people who are going to buy it. So that means producing for the interests of the industrial societies in the north and trying to maximize their consumption at prices that can maximize your profit. What's happening as a result is that more and more of the world's fertile land is being used up. The other problem is that the very methods of industrial agriculture are diminishing the soil. We degrade the soil at a rate that it can't renew itself in time for us to continue producing enough food.
Great new harvesting systems and distribution methods had to be developed to bring these crops from faraway farms fresh to our tables.
You have this skewered international system of food distribution. The majority of people in the less developed countries are working as displaced farmers, working on these agribusiness complexes, producing food which is then exported to the richer countries of the West for very cheap prices. And where are they supposed to get their food from? Well, they're buying food produced in the West very expensively, and they can't afford to buy the food. All of these combined factors, economic inequality, industrial debilitation of the soil, peak energy, climate degradation, ecological degradation, all converging, and we will increasingly see over the next decade higher food prices in terms of staple foods like corn, wheat, and so on. And we will find more and more people in the less developed countries subject to malnutrition and starvation. And slowly over time, this could come to afflict the Western countries. All of these factors are consistently pushing us towards a solution based on participatory forms of organization, more localized forms of agriculture, more organic forms of agriculture, which aren't reliant on oil. And I think overall, the question that we need to ask is that form of agriculture going to be sufficient to maintain our needs? Is it desirable to sustain the kind of levels of overconsumption, perhaps, that go on in Western countries? Certainly, we need to stop wasting so much food as we do here in the West. We throw away millions of tons of food. This is an inherent part of the supermarket system, and it's part of the profit-making incentive. Is there a way in which we can reduce that? Can we sustain high levels of consumption under organic agriculture? One of the best studies I read was done by the University of Michigan and their environment department. And they argued that actually, even if you look at current levels of growth, and we envisage a population of 11 billion people, we could actually implement a form of organic, localized, no pesticide agriculture that would actually feed 11 billion people. And that would be clean, that wouldn't be reliant on fossil fuels. And that's a very astounding and very interesting study. Being pragmatic about it, I would say, let's imagine that that's not the case. We are seeing an overall message that we do not want to keep growing. This infinite growth has to stop. We need to reach a limit. We need to have a steady state system of some kind. And if we do that, then I think a future picture of forms of localized organic agriculture could be much more sustainable, much more viable, and much more accessible to communities.
Now came the moment we'd waited for so long. Out we went, gay as larks. The first trowelful of earth was like a ceremony, more wonderful than any other soil. Miraculous in the hand, our land.
The fundamental issue is, who owns the land? Who owns productive resources? Unfortunately, we have a situation where something like 1%, literally 1% of the world's population, dominate and own the entirety of the world's productive resources, and the rest of us are completely dispossessed. So it's clearly something that, as a structural issue, has to change if we're going to overcome this problem of unlimited growth and if we're going to overcome this problem of overexploitation of resources. And fundamentally, if we're going to get to a point where we can talk seriously about people getting directly involved in food production, all of us have got a stake in this. It's not just about we, the people, and them, the evil corporates. All of us are in for a rough ride. And unfortunately, at the moment, all of us are rather blinkered about it.
And now, intermission. Refreshment time.
It's refreshment time, folks.
Hello, I'm Mr. Money. People can't seem to get along without me as cash or credit.
Well, here we are again.
Yeah. Oh, hi, Mr. Money.
Hello, John. And how are you today, Judy?
Just great.
You remember our learning machine over there?
Well, sure, that's a great gadget.
What's it going to teach us today, Mr. Money?
I'll turn it on and you'll see.
One of the areas where we're seeing the feedback effects of different crises is the economic recession. It's very, very clear that the underlying issue of energy and our ability to sustain economic growth has been dependent on the cheap, widely available abundance of fossil fuels. This goes against the grain of neoliberal economic theory, which analyzes everything in isolation and doesn't acknowledge that the economy is embedded in the environment, that the economy is embedded in energy sources. Currently, we have a fractional reserve banking system. This system is based on the idea that you have a certain amount of assets in reserve in your bank, and that you have the ability to lend out certain multiples of that asset in the form of money. So for example, you have £1 in reserve. You can lend out multiples of 8 to 10 times the amount that you actually have. What they said in the 1990s is, this is not enough. We want new ways of making money. We want to be able to lend unlimited amounts. How can we do that? They said, let's have risk assessment models created by banks. And they would assess the levels of risk using these complex computer models. And if you could prove with these quantitative models that your levels of risk were very, very small, they could then justify lending at multiples of 1,000 times the amount that you've got in your reserves. And this is what made the whole process of financialization very, very interesting for capitalists, because you didn't have to produce anything. You didn't have to produce goods and services anymore. All you had to do was lend money to someone else who might be making goods and services or selling a product. And the more you lent them, the more they had to pay you back on compound interest. Obviously, you can see that this system was pretty much unsustainable because the global economy is a closed circle. I mean, how are you going to pay back money that isn't in the system? For you to pay it back, you need to borrow more. And for you to pay it back, you need to produce more and you need to exploit the environment more and you need to grow more. So it accelerated the pressure for unlimited growth.
Millions of people use credit to buy the things that add up to a better living.
Well, there's sure a lot of things that I'd like to buy for better living. How about giving me a little credit?
Nobody gives you credit, John. It's something you have to earn.
I don't understand, Mr. Money. How can you earn credit?
Well, we'll select another channel on the learning machine by remote control and see.
In the late 90s, banks were going crazy lending to people. And one of the areas where they were making the biggest profits was in the housing markets and on mortgages, where they were lending to people who they knew couldn't pay it back.
You have a good reputation. We know you're reliable.
I'm glad you think so.
Here's the note, and this is where you sign.
They were then repackaging these mortgages as financial products that were safe to invest in, and then were selling them on. They were then saying, in the case that there was a default and that the guy didn't actually pay back the mortgage, we'll insure you, so you don't have to worry, it's very, very safe. The guys who were insuring, they didn't have any capital either, they didn't have any money to insure, and they were taking money in. And it was just this massive bubble. It became something like $1.2 quadrillion in size. That's $1,000 trillion of virtual money. Compare that to $60 trillion, which was the value of the real world economy. So what you're seeing is there's a massive disparity between real life buying and selling and this virtual financialization debt bubble. What happened in 2005 to 2008 is that that bubble reached the limits of the energy system, the reality check, that you can't grow infinitely. There is a real world, which is the boundary limit of what you can do. And at that point in 2008, when oil supply was dipping and demand was growing, that bubble is almost as if it was in a box. It couldn't grow anymore and it just burst. And at that point, the prices rocketed, inflation went through the roof, food prices went up, cost of living went up. Obviously, oil prices were going up and that was driving the prices of everything else going up. Because of all of these factors, people found it incredibly difficult to repay their mortgages. Because mortgages underpinned so much of the growth that was going on in the economy, it was a tipping point that ended up collapsing the whole house of cards.
This is the BBC Home Service. Here is the 8 o'clock news. Sir John Ingram, speaking of the economic crisis at Worcester last night, warned the people of Britain to face further cuts in the near future. He stressed the importance of a rigid economy and appealed to everyone to accept the present austerity with fortitude and optimism. A foreign correspondent commenting on the speech said,
but if you look at how governments are responding, they're not looking at the system and trying to change it. Instead, they're strengthening and centralizing it more. So who were the first people to suffer as a consequence of the recession? It was your average consumer. It was your average person on the street. The taxpayers, whose money went into a massive bank bailout, which was used to cover up the insolvency of the banks. What that did in practice is that it centralized the power of the banks. It gave them a pat on the head that after you guys royally cocked up, we're going to pay you some more money from the taxpayers who suffered. And meanwhile, by taking that money out of the economy, they actually made things worse. So you contracted the real economy, the productive economy, where things were needing to happen. And you created more business failures, more small business failures, more real economy contraction. At the same time, while these businesses failed, the larger companies, especially the big banks, who were now empowered by the massive bailouts that had come in, they started buying up a lot of these other businesses. So you had a situation where more centralization of ownership was also taking place.
It's Saturday night, and everyone else is out having fun. It's the best excuse in the world to join the party.
The reason why governments are responding in a way which is not dealing with the real issues is because they're adhering to this neoliberal ideology of the so-called free market system, which promotes this idea that states should have a really limited role in the economy and that we should just completely open markets and give free rein to private investors to pretty much do what they like. The reason there's a fundamental conflict between the free market ideology as it stands or as it's promoted and real world democracy as we would like it to be, it's just because we elect our representatives in order for them to actually organize societies, organize economies, you know, make policy decisions that are for everybody's benefit. But what the free market ideology does is it organizes the economy in such a way that the state should actually have no real role. So in other words, the free market ideology is actually taking power for these economic decisions and transactions completely out of the hands of the public, and giving free rein to all manner of actors and vested interests that have nothing to do with the popular will. Now, this ideology on a global scale is being pushed through by these global governance institutions, mainly the IMF, the International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, as well as the World Trade Organization. And what they're doing in countries in the South are often suffering from huge levels of deprivation. They have many political and social problems, and they do need credit. Is they're saying to these countries that if you're going to receive our loans, then you're going to have to abide by our rules for development. And what this actually does is it forces these countries to restructure their societies on the basis of these structural adjustment packages, to open their markets, to completely deregulate their societies, and to allow these private investors, largely based in the West, to come in and pretty much do what they like, to buy up resources, to invest, to take out capital whenever they feel like it. Essentially, it opens up these societies to the predatory exploits of transnational capital based in the West.
Hello, George. Jim Chandler. Oh, I'm fine, thank you. Say, George, I have a gentleman I'd like to bring over to talk about locating a factory here. I thought you would. 11? Fine, we'll be there.
You don't waste much time.
Well,
but that's what we heard about you.
What this means is that neoliberal globalization, a so-called free market ideology, is a broken system. It hasn't worked. On the pretext of creating growth and creating wealth, which they say is going to somehow trickle down to everybody, what they've actually done is centralize profits for a minority, is extract the resources, raw materials, and labor within these countries for the benefit of a few, while accelerating huge levels of deprivation and debt in most of the world. And this process has empowered northern industrial centers to continue on this path of overconsumption and unlimited growth, which in turn has accelerated global crises. We've explored climate change, peak energy, food insecurity, economic crises. We've seen how these crises are all fundamentally interrelated and that they're being driven by this ideology of neoliberal capitalism. This has also helped us to recognize that the overarching assumption that we are living in the most advanced optimal system ever for humanity, what Fukuyama predicted to be the end of history, is fundamentally flawed. And if we look at the war on terror, we can see that Samuel Huntington's ideas about the clash of civilizations have become a self-fulfilling prophecy. International terrorism is often viewed as a problem that is either outside Western civilization and competing with it, or internal to communities who happen to be part of Western civilization but are not truly accepting of it and challenging it from within. That's putting it very simplistically, but that's the general sense of the conventional way of approaching terrorism. A quite different picture emerges when you start tracking the financial infrastructure behind actual international terrorist networks. So if you look at most of the Islamist-affiliated terrorist groups linked to Al-Qaeda, there is generally a consistent set of evidence which shows that they are financed by certain groups of states in the Middle East and Central Asia, states like Saudi Arabia, Pakistan. One of the other interesting issues that isn't well known is the way in which the West has intersected with this relationship and why the West has done so.
May 1933, after weeks of discussions, there was a meeting at Kazan Palace on the outskirts of Jeddah. It was there that Saudi Arab government officials representing His Majesty signed a concession covering roughly 320,000 square miles. This was the starting point of a new American business venture abroad. But ahead, there was a long, long distance to travel, a huge investment, years of effort, and no end of patience and perseverance.
It's very important that we recognize how significant hydrocarbon energy resources are to the international system. To maintain production, to maintain electricity, to maintain agriculture, we are dependent on certain types of fossil fuel resources.
The problem is that most of these resources are available largely in specific areas of the Middle East and Central Asia.
And historically, for us to have actually maintained control and access to these resources in a cheap way, in an easy way, what we've done is we have teamed up with very, very repressive regimes in these regions, Saudi Arabia being one example, who are willing to supply to us on the terms that we like cheap sources of oil and gas. Part of the process has involved militarily propping up these regimes at any cost. We know for a fact that these regimes are also sponsoring terrorist activities. So there is a clear decision that's been made in the sense that we have continued to maintain ties with these regimes, knowing full well what's going on. The other issue is that not only have we done that, we've actually gone further than that. In order to control hydrocarbon energy resources and to extend that control, we've actually got more involved in the sponsorship of those groups and used them deliberately as mercenary proxy force in order to destabilize certain strategic regions that are either access routes to this kind of energy or actually hold that kind of energy. The policy of using proxy forces has happened in many regions. One of the most obvious examples is in Afghanistan, where we know this happened during the Cold War. The US funded Osama bin Laden and his Mujahideen in order to counter the Soviet Union, the pretext being that we were fighting international communism. The wider context that we are not always familiar with is that Afghanistan has a very important geostrategic position in the international system, and this has been expressed by many experts in geopolitics. One of the most influential is Zbigniew Brzezinski, who was National Security Advisor to President Carter, and more recently an unofficial advisor to President Obama. He wrote a book called The Grand Chessboard, where he emphasized Afghanistan's relationship to the wider Eurasian continent in terms of an access point, and that maintaining control of Eurasia is instrumental to maintaining US hegemony in general. Brzezinski was also instrumental in kickstarting the policy of funding bin Laden and the Mujahideen in order to kick the Soviets out of Afghanistan, whose presence would have undermined US control in the region. But that relationship didn't end in Afghanistan at the end of the Cold War. The conventional opinion is that the US disconnected from bin Laden, he turned against the West, started bombing Western targets, and that this escalated until 9/11, at which point we had to respond in the form of the War on Terror. There are broad areas of that narrative that I might say are correct, but there are fundamental problems with it. And one of the most fundamental problems is that we never really disconnected from Osama bin Laden. This has been corroborated by a number of intelligence experts. One of the most well-known is Sibel Edmonds, who after 9/11 was translating hundreds of pre-9/11 intelligence documents for the FBI. And she has confirmed that Osama bin Laden and the Taliban were sponsored by US intelligence services all the way up to 9/11 at the very least. She was interviewed behind closed doors by the 9/11 Commission, but none of her testimony made it into the public record. And she has been repeatedly gagged by the US government and risks imprisonment for speaking out. What this shows us is that due to our rabid overdependence on fossil fuels, we have become very used to using terrorist groups to destabilize certain strategic regions in order to integrate them into the global political economy and access their valuable resources.
Now that the risks have been taken, now that the pioneering has been done, the way is open for other American companies to come into the Middle East and join in developing its great resources for the benefit of its people and of the world.
The West has been manipulating these groups for very specific geopolitical interests.
We know that this was happening with the sponsorship of the Taliban all the way through the 1990s, with the primary interest being that the Taliban would pave the way for sufficient stability to have a trans-Afghan gas pipeline route to Central Asian resources. The envisaged pipeline that would run through Afghanistan was supposed to be a way of accessing largely at that time unexplored reserves of oil and gas in the Caspian Sea. And it would cut across Pakistan, bypass Russia, and it would bypass Iran and transport this gas to Western markets. What we find is that in late 2000, the US government started to have doubts about the Taliban's ability to really pull this off. And this was because the Taliban was fighting a civil war with the Northern Alliance for which there was no end in sight. So from the year 2000 to 2001, the United States government convened a series of meetings and negotiations with the Taliban. The Taliban were basically told, you're not going to have a stable government by yourself. The Northern Alliance is continuing to fight with you. We need you to join up with the Northern Alliance, form a federal government. And if you do that, you'll get all the aid, you get international legitimacy, and we can continue with the gas pipeline. And the Taliban, being the hardliners that they were, said, no, thanks. We are the legitimate representative government of Afghanistan, we believe, and we're going to stay where we are. And 3 months before 9/11 was when the last meeting occurred, and the Taliban boycotted this meeting, but they were represented by Pakistani Foreign Minister Niaz Naik, who confirmed that the United States government had proposed to the Taliban that if they didn't comply with this federalization plan, that there would be military action to eliminate the Taliban, and that this action would occur by around mid-October that year, which is exactly when the war in Afghanistan actually occurred. The phrase that was used was that they would get either a carpet of gold or a carpet of bombs. And what this shows us is that the war in Afghanistan was not about fighting terrorism. It was not even a direct response to 9/11. It was already being planned. 9/11 just provided the pretext, and it was much more to do with accessing regional resources than anything to do with human rights or fighting terrorism. And now you see with the escalation of the war in Afghanistan, right now, US and British forces are trying to expel the Taliban from the southern region of Afghanistan, which is precisely where the Trans-Afghan pipeline is supposed to run. What we can say with certainty, and I prefer to stick to what we can say with absolute certainty, is that the system generates terrorism as a phenomenon, that terrorism has become integral to the way the system works, and this justifies the state's militarization of foreign policy. And it also justifies the state's increasingly draconian treatment of its own citizens. Overall, we are facing these multiple converging crises.
Climate change, energy, food, the economy, and even terrorism, all of which are escalating.
What's happening in this context is that rather than dealing with the root structural causes of these crises,
which are often rooted in state policies and interstate policies, what you're seeing instead is states are much more able and willing to maximize their military capacity to maintain the structure of an unequal global economic system, often using terrorism as a justification. And we find that a parallel process is happening domestically. Governments are increasingly enacting more and more legislation that encroaches on civil liberties, that allows them to survey communities, monitor people's lives, their ability to control their populations, their ability to counteract the rise of dissident movements.
Civil defense government operating in an emergency. By 10:55, the heads of utilities, Red Cross, military liaison, Civil Air Patrol, Weather Bureau, and all city departments are functioning as a civil defense team.
When you look at some of the defense planning documents that have been released from the British, from the European Union, from the United States, planning documents created by defense planners, people working in the military. What's interesting about the documents is that a lot of them show that many of the people working on national security are aware of some of these crises. They are looking at climate change and they're saying, climate change is going to be a problem. They're looking at food shortages, they're looking at energy shortages, they're looking at water shortages and they're saying, there's going to be massive stress. It's important to understand that the people creating these plans work in the military. They're not necessarily part of a big conspiracy of any kind. They're on a salary and they're told, okay, look at these crises, find out what's going on, let's think about it. What's driving this process of militarization is a very narrow lens of looking at the world. And again, it does come back to these implicit assumptions about how the world works, these neoliberal ideas about us living in the most advanced system possible. So what you find is that when you have all of these implicit assumptions about the way the world works, and then you're coming at it from a military angle, which is all about, well, we need to defend this society against new threats, then the only way you can respond to it, if you're going to look at it from that angle, is with guns. Even though guns are never going to solve your problem, because you can't deal with economics with guns. You can't deal with melting glaciers with guns. You can't deal with the fact that you're depleting your oil reserves with guns. But when you've paid a couple of defense planners, then they're only going to come up with solutions based on guns because that's all they know.
The time is 11:10. This is an official civil defense broadcast.
Keep your radio tuned to this frequency.
In the UK, we have what is called the Civil Contingencies Act, which passed in 2004. The government now has extraordinary powers which it can impose on its own will if it considers that there is a national emergency. Now, what's worrying is that the things that the government is able to do in the context of such an emergency are really extraordinary. So they could confiscate property, anybody's property. They can set up new courts outside of the existing judicial system to pass judgment on things. They can cancel elections. They can set up curfews whenever they feel like, so to stop people from traveling at certain times. They can cordon off entire public areas and simply prevent people from accessing them. They can arrest people and detain them for any duration of time. What it basically does is pave the way to a full-on authoritarian state and the end of democracy. Some people might think that I'm being alarmist, but it is alarming, and I think we should all be alarmed because the legislation really speaks for itself.
And so this day called X, which began in such an ordinary way, is no ordinary day. At 10:35, the banshee wail of the siren echoes the warning, and the city prepares for survival.
These powers have nothing to do with responding effectively in a robust way to national emergencies. When you look at what the government should be doing in terms of looking locally, assessing the different kinds of risks, looking at what facilities and infrastructures are existing in different parts of the country, what do we need to do to increase the capacity of our facilities to respond effectively to real emergencies? What is the government actually doing on the ground to make us empowered to respond properly and appropriately? Nothing is happening. The government's not doing anything. There's no investment. There's no real analysis. There are some processes in place, but it's very, very minimal. So when you compare that level of inaction with the huge level of interest in maximizing the state's powers, their police powers, their military powers, and their powers of social control, there's this massive gulf. And it's very clear to me that all of this acceleration of state power at the expense of our civil liberties and our human rights and our dignity as individuals is happening in direct response to the fact that at its fundamental level they're losing control, and they're more and more worried about maintaining order, maintaining the status quo, maintaining business as usual. Rather than dealing with the real causes, all they're doing is dealing with symptoms, while things actually will continue to get worse because the systemic causes of this crisis convergence are still there.
I never did anything bad. Honest.
Look at yourself real close.
What I'm seeing really is that a lot of the mainstream conventional thinking, it's not self-reflective enough. There isn't enough capacity to look at what we have done wrong. What have we done as our societies that isn't working, that needs to change? There's not enough willingness to accept that maybe the path that we've gone on hasn't been optimal, hasn't been the best way for humanity ever.
Welcome to the world of tomorrow. Climb aboard. You are about to take a journey out of this world into the world of the future. Forget the world around you. Forget the people around you. You are entering Futurama, alone with your own thoughts.
These crises really, in a way, are symptoms of a process of transition. Transition to another form of civilization, another form of social and political and economic and cultural organization. I think the urgent question that we need to be asking ourselves is what comes after? What is the post-carbon, post-peak world going to look like? And that is really up to us. It's pretty clear that we cannot continue growing on a single planet endlessly. What this means is that if we are going to overcome these crises, we need to rethink our whole understanding of the human condition and our relationship to our environment and our relationship to one another, and that we need to move away from some of these prevailing ideas and values that have dominated our current drive towards unlimited material growth, which is being driven by these consumerist values to do with the idea that human well-being is linked to increasing consumption of material products and increasing acquisition of material goods. So do we need to ditch the whole concept of growth? Well, I do think that we need to reject the material concept of unlimited economic growth. But we can still retain the idea of social progress, that there is some kind of moving forward, but we need to redefine what we mean by moving forwards, by getting better, by advancing. And rather than defining this in material terms, in terms of material production and consumption, we need to be defining it in terms of meeting people's basic needs, recognizing that any kind of material progress that we might make in and of itself means nothing if it doesn't cater for these more fundamental goals that all of us hold to be so important. Things like having clean water, education, literacy, things like spiritual fulfillment, things like community, family, things like well-being. There may be some material components to that, but what we find then is that the material conditions of life, rather than being the fundamental goal, rather, those are simply tools to achieve these much more important values.
Jimmy. Don't be frightened. We are your friends.
We need to accept that the overabundance of fossil fuels has been linked to the ability to continue on this path of unlimited growth. There are many viable alternatives to fossil fuels. There is solar energy, wind energy, geothermal energy. As we've discussed, scaling up this process of transitioning to renewable energy infrastructure wouldn't be feasible. So we need to be recognizing that there should be more localization, there needs to be much less consumption of natural resources, that we need to be lowering our footprint on the earth. Renewable energy alternatives do not allow us to continue business as usual. What they allow us to do is to contract our societies to a form which is much more sustainable and much more in parity with the environment and the earth.
Out of the slime and darkness it comes to inflict its life-destroying poison on the careless, the unwary, the unprotected. No sane person would deliberately expose himself to its venom. No intelligent person would venture within striking distance of its fangs. Yet today, young people are flirting with a poison every bit as deadly as that of the snake.
I think certainly the way forward for looking at the banks is, at a minimum, we want to see a fundamental separation of the activities of the financial sector, where banks are investing and speculating on stock markets and shares and so on and so forth, and we have this fictional financial whirlwind going on. Separate that out from basic retail banking, where a person goes to the bank, deposits their money for safekeeping, and goes away. They want to know that their money is their money, and that banks aren't going to be playing around with that, and that it's going to be in jeopardy. That's one thing. On the other hand, we need to completely rethink the way money is created in the first place by banks. We need to accept that interest hasn't worked. It's actually generated and fundamentally created this whirlwind of unrepayable debt, which leads to cyclical economic failures. We need to be looking at the entire way that banks are structured and that money is created, and to start thinking about fundamental alternatives that communities can start engaging in now. What we're talking about is creating new forms of currency, new forms of exchange, and making them much more in parity with the real world. One of the most significant key structural problems is the fact that the vast majority of the world's population lives in a state of dispossession. By dispossession, I mean that they do not have access or ownership or use rights for land, resources, raw materials. This condition is one of the key causes that has generated a lot of the most regressive dynamics of capitalism in its current form. So it's essential that we challenge this condition of dispossession fundamentally. Communities are going to have access to land to produce food. If they don't, then they're not going to be able to eat, because supply chains are going to be damaged as a result of peak oil. Fossil fuels will not be providing food in the way that we were able to do so in the past. Industrial agriculture is failing. So in the post-peak world, we need to be exploring new forms of social organization that allow communities to open up access to land, to resources, to the commons. And certainly, we need to have a dialogue about how this happens. I'm not saying that I have a simple answer or a blueprint for the way forward, but this is something that needs to emerge organically from communities themselves. It's important to recognize that existing institutions and structures are more than likely to doggedly pursue their own vested interests, even as this accelerates global crises.
But this just means that it's absolutely essential for us as communities to become much more resilient to these shocks. We're going to have to become much more localized, participatory, and grassroots in how we do things like food, energy, and the economy. And this is going to be essential for us not just to prosper, but to survive.